So next text is MA scan. It is called macro aggregate albumin scan. So injection of technetium 99 m labeled macro albumin scan. It is called abbreviated as MA scan. Okay. So this is more invasive test but less sensitive tests. Okay. Here in this test, particles with 20 to 50 micrometer size are injected, and it passes through the venous circulation and reach right heart, and from there it goes to lungs. Let's suppose this is lung, and here actually they pass through these pulmonary capillaries to post capillaries and then to systemic circulation. So it scattered through the abnormal pulmonary capillaries and stain downstream capillary beds supplied by systemic arteries such as the brain, kidney and spleen. So normally these actually do not pass through the pulmonary capillaries, but due to abnormal pulmonary vascular dilatation in hepatopulmonary syndrome, these macro aggregate albumin pass through the pulmonary capillaries and stay down in downstream capillary beds supplied by systemic arteries such as the brain, kidney and spleen. And quantitative imaging of the MA scan in brain and lung enables calculation of the degree of shunting. So quantitative imaging helps to calculate the degree of shunting. The measurement of shunting with MA scan may be useful as a complementary diagnostic tool in patients with two clinical situations. Okay. So it is helpful as a complementary diagnostic tool in this following two clinical situations. Okay, firstly in patients with severe hypoxemia and coexisting HPS and intrinsic lung disease. So if patient has hypoxemia and patient also has intrinsic lung disease and HPS coexisting, then how we can differentiate? So here comes the role of MA scan. Okay, so in this condition, shunting greater than 6% at MA scan probe the major contribution of HPS to hypoxemia. So if shunting is greater than 6%, then you can say that the major contributing factor to hypoxemia is hepatopulmonary syndrome. Secondly, in patients with HPS and very severe hypoxemia, less than 50 mmHg, since the presence of shunting greater than 20% is associated with poor outcome after liver transplantation. Okay, and secondly, in patients with HPS and who have severe hypoxemia, less than 50 mmHg, since why? Because the presence of shunting, if 20% is greater, is associated with poor outcome after liver transplantation. So despite the potential role of lung perfusion scintigraphy for prognostic use in patients with cirrhosis and intrapulmonary vascular dilatation, its diagnostic accuracy for HPS remains to be established. Neither contrast echo nor MAA scan can differentiate discrete arteriovenous communication from diffuse precapillary and capillary dilatation or intracardiac shunt. So this, how to differentiate this? The former distinction can be made by means of pulmonary angiography, and this latter distinction can be made by means of transesophageal contrast echo that directly reveals the intra-arterial septum. Okay, and pulmonary angio should not be performed in all patients with suspected HPS, but only in patients with severe hypoxemia, PO2 less than 60 mmHg, poorly responsive to administration of 100% oxygen, and patients strongly suspected by means of CT chest of having arteriovenous communication that would be amenable to embolization. So only in these two conditions we do pulmonary angiography. Okay, in HPS and natural history of HPS, the natural history of intrapulmonary vascular dilatation as well as of HPS is still unclear. Most patients with intrapulmonary vascular dilatation maintain a normal gas exchange over time, and it is not clear the reason why a subset of patients with IPVT develops HPS. A diagnosis of HPS is associated with poor outcome in terms of both survival and quality of life. So regarding survival, it should be highlighted that in patients undergoing evaluation for liver transplantation, the mortality rate was almost double in patients with HPS compared to patients with cirrhosis without HPS. Independent of other potential predictors of mortality like age, MELD score and comorbidities, in patients with cirrhosis and HPS who were not evaluated for liver transplant, 5 year survival rate was 23%, while it was 63% in patients with cirrhosis without HPS, who were matched for etiology and severity of cirrhosis according to the child per classification, age and MELD score. And survival was significantly worse among patients with HPS and PaO2 less than 50 mmHg at the time of diagnosis. Now let's discuss about management. So there are two management, medical management and liver transplant. The liver transplant is the most common and only successful treatment for hepatopulmonary syndrome. Regarding medical treatment, many drugs have been proposed in different studies, but there is no consensus on this drug management, and this drug management has not been found to be helpful as well. Long-term oxygen therapy remains the most frequently recommended therapy for symptoms in patients with severe hypoxemia. Spontaneous resolution of HPS is uncommon. You have to remember this. Many drugs have been applied for treatment of HPS with conflicting results. Data from several studies indicate that treatment with beta blocker, COX inhibitors, cyclooxygenase inhibitors, systemic glucocorticoids, and cyclophosphamide, amitriptyline bisphosphonate, inhaled nitric oxide inhibitors, and antimicrobial agents have been uniformly unsuccessful. Okay, so these are unsuccessful. And coil therapy has been shown to improve arterial oxygenation temporarily in the context of angiographic arteriovenous communications.